before they came inside heaven to worship the king. So the announcement has taken place. The invitation has taken place. Meaning, they are now revivals. Hallelujah. Exodus 28, beloved people. And again, I'm very happy to come to you through TV service, that your nation may gather when all the nations gather. Hallelujah. So I'm reading Exodus 28, beloved people. I'll read one verse and then the translator one verse. And I must mention here that the translator has improved very much. It's very powerful right now. The Lord bless you. The Lord bless you. Is it better? Is it better translation? Are you following me? Is she good? That's good. Is it powerful? Thank you. I want to make sure you get the message, right? Yes, the nation of the Exodus 28. Verse 1 it says, have Aaron your brother be brought to you from among the Israelites, along with Nadab and Abihu, Eleazar and Ithamar, so that they may serve me as priests. Verse 2. Make sacred garments for your brother Aaron. You see now the instruction. When he started to appear before the king, now he said, make for him a sacred garment for appearing. Make sacred garments for your brother Aaron to give him dignity and honor. Again, it is as if you begin to understand that when Aaron was roaming out there in the camp of the Israelites, it is as if he's saying Aaron did not have dignity and honor. Because he's saying that this garment, when Aaron will wear this garment, will now give him dignity and honor. That is amazing, beloved. And then if you read the other version, they said to give him glory and beauty. Glory and beauty. And if you read further on, you say, for his consecration, meaning the garment bestows upon you consecration, which is separation. Consecration means set apart, holy unto the Lord. That's why the priests in Israel, they wore the tabard, and inside was written, set apart, holy unto the Lord. Within the prophetic timeline of God, the time to appear has arrived. And he said, take on the skilled men to whom I have given wisdom in such matters that they are to make sacred garments for Aaron. For his consecration, so he may serve me in the office of priest. So that is astounding. That is so enormous. That's very big. Why is this very big? Because it is as if he's saying that Pentecost has already happened here.
He's saying that the visitation of the Holy Spirit has taken place among some people here. Because he's telling Moses, go to some people there. And I think one maybe Bezalel, another Bezalel. Go to some people near inside there. I have already released my spirit on them. So for those of you who are interested in revivalism, demarcating the prophetic timeline of revival, when does Pentecost, when did the dispensation of grace begin, and so forth, you might be interested in this. Because he's saying that there are some people, go to them, some people that I have released my spirit from on high and I've filled them with the spirit and given them wisdom on how to prepare such matters like that. Amen. So,
Niinpä.
They make for Aaron a sacred garment. When it is time for Aaron to appear before Jehovah, then now Jehovah has a requirement, a standard. And that standard is the garment. Hallelujah. The garment. And those of you who are here in the morning, when I read from Revelation chapter 19, verses 6, verse 9, he celebrates that garment as the righteousness of the church. And he also says that that garment is given to us gratis as a gift of grace and mercy. Grace and mercy. That is powerful. He's also saying that this garment that we need to appear, to enter, is actually the reward, the reward that the church in Europe, in Finland, will receive. The Lord is talking about the reward. I give you a reward. I give you a reward for your perseverance. I know what you pass through. If you decide, for example, as a lady or a young man, to walk holy, you might lose your friends. There is a form of persecution. There is a kind of tribulation. There are times of trials that happen to people that choose righteousness at this hour, even in Kenya, everywhere. If you choose righteousness, you will always meet resistance. Even in the United States, it's worse. When you choose righteousness, you might lose all your friends. You might even lose your job. I know somebody in Kenya, one of my daughters, really, spiritual daughters, because they just dress holy, But she lost the job because of holy dressing. She had to choose between Jesus and the job. What is the message there? Probably I'm saying to these people that this is the hour to stand up and choose Jesus. No matter what. Yes. Because the Lord is saying that don't make a mistake of losing this God. This God is the reward. He gives the child recompense, compensation for the tribulation, for the persecution, for every difficulty, for every abuse, blackmail, over. In the days of Noah, Noah was building an ark, and everybody laughed at Noah. Everybody mocked at him.
kirouksesi, palkinnoksi kaiken on kärsimyksestä ja pirkasta ja kaikista mitä on koettu. Niin nuonkin päivänä Nooma pilattiin ja hän joutui kärsimään paljon sen kutsunnan takia.
Because now,
koska nyt,
if you were holy in this city, let's say you are a woman and you decide to dress holy.
Jos vaikka naisena tässä kaupungissa päätän tukeutua
pyhä. And then the people in your world would ask you, why are you dressing like this? And then you tell them, because the Messiah is coming. They will laugh at you. They will laugh at you. Because they will say, but we have heard that for many years. They will ask, are you crazy? So when Noah was building an ark, everybody thought he was crazy. The ark of deliverance. The earth of righteousness, the earth of holiness, the earth of God, the earth of salvation, and only those who enter the earth may are saved. Did you understand? Because he said, this is too modern here. If you try to live holy, you meet resistance, they call it the headwinds.
Jos haluat elää pyhästi, niin sitten törmät vastustukseen.
But not just here, I get the example of Kenya, one of my spiritual daughters.
Päätuulia, niin kun annoin Keniasta
Energiasta. And then senior executive
of a company, senior ja sitten tämmöisen firman vanhempi johtaja.
And then they told her, no.
Ne sanoi, ei.
We have a dressing code.
Meillä on pukeutumiskoodi.
In this company.
Tässä on firmassa.
So she had to quit the job.
Niinpä nämä naiset täytyy
lopettaa. We will always face persecution if we choose Jesus. Why? Because we testify against the sin of this world, the sin. I come to testify against the sin in the church in
Finland.
If somebody will ask you, okay, the man of God came, what did he say? What message did he give?
From
the world, us as Christians,
many Christians,
the church, the believers, from the other religions, from the Hindus, from the Moses, from the New Age, only righteousness of Jesus. And that righteousness, if you read Philippians chapter 3 verse 8, he says, behold, the righteousness of Jehovah. Hallelujah. And that righteousness, when you read the book of Philippians chapter 3, which we are not reading now, you find that that righteousness is not ours. We did not labor for it. That righteousness was imputed, was calculated for us as faith, faith in Jesus. He's telling the church that you cannot be like the other religions. The Son of the Living God Himself has come and died for you. The Son of the Living God has died for you. How can you be like other people? The Bible says, you are being purchased, meaning you are not yourself. Now you live for Christ. But when I look at the church in Finland, there is a casual relationship with God. Casual. Sometimes you meet friends, they drink beer. Sometimes the friends meet and drink wine. Sometimes a man and a woman live together without marriage. Sometimes they lie. They tell the pastor, no, I am not in town this weekend. But they are in town. So when you look at the church in that condition where the time comes up, the show starts, they're showing their bodies, you are like, oh, they are like sheep without a shepherd. Nobody has given them direction. I have been all over the world, from New Zealand to Finland to South Korea to Canada. I have been all over the world, Africa. And I have never found anybody that told me that they went to church because they want to go to heaven. Did you understand? Everybody wants to go to heaven. Then let us embrace righteousness. Let us be serious. Because he says that the church also, I have given a prophecy that I have seen the church appear before the king and worship the king. I have seen them worshiping. I have seen the church worshiping before the throne. And he said that there is a requirement that now we must wear the garment of salvation. And he said that when we wear that is the difference between us and everybody else. Look at this now. When Aaron wore that garment, he became an emblem, a symbol. A symbol of his holy conduct, holy behavior. Even the church, when you wear righteousness, that becomes the symbol of your holy conduct before the Lord and the world. Hallelujah. I love Jesus. Because he said, behold, I come like a thief. Meaning, come, it will surprise you. But look at me now. But he sends me, he speaks with me, he shows me the way, and sends me to warn you before it happens. Hallelujah. you are going to come like a thief. That is the love of God that we receive from Calvary. Hallelujah. And so listen, beloved. He's saying that right now, as I say to the world, the scripture in Revelation 19 is saying, fine linen, bright and clean, was given to the church to wear. And listen to this now. And then I say, wow, if it is bright, then that means the Lord is saying that when we are born again and we wear righteousness and repent of our sins and make deliberate effort to be holy. And the Holy Spirit now help us. He said that our salvation is supposed to be broadcast. It is supposed to shine to the nation. Shine. Meaning, if I walk out in the street now and there is a Christian coming towards me, I should be able to tell that this is a Christian. Oh yes. He said there must be a difference. Because Jesus did not die in vain. The Son of the Living God Himself died. He died for us. That's an enormous price.
So,
but He's saying that now is incumbent upon us. Because He's saying, so He said, let us shout and let us be glad and give Him glory. For the day of the wedding has come, and the bride of Christ, the bride, has made herself meaning there is a role, the church has a role, has made herself ready. If you go to the book of Isaiah chapter 53, then you see the price that Jesus paid to purchase for us this eternity we are talking about. Let us read, beloved. Isaiah 53. Hallelujah. Isaiah 53, you can read all through, but verses 5, verse 1, verse 5, verse 10 are very important also. But that's what you can read everything. Hallelujah. Okay, thank you. So Isaiah 53. I just read briefly, so I will explain. I'll read briefly. He said from verse 1. Who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. He had no beauty or majesty that would pull us to him. And then he talks about his appearance. And he said, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. Verse 3 says, he was rejected, he was despised and rejected by men. And he said, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering, like one from whom men should hide away their faces. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Verse 4, surely he took our infirmities, but verse 5 and verse 10. Verse 5 he says, but he was pierced for our transgressions. the price the Messiah paid for us. If you go to Psalm 22, you meet him there. If you go to the same Isaiah 52, verse 14, you meet him there. Verse 14. Isaiah 52, 14, he says. He says, just as many were appalled at him, who were appalled at him, his appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any man. And his likeness did not look like any human. So you can imagine the polarization, the crushing of the Messiah. Beloved people, this is the price the Messiah paid for the garment I am announcing the church should wear, the garment of righteousness. But when you read Revelation chapter 19, verses 6 to 9, that announces the coming of the Messiah, you hear him say this. Listen to other people. He said, fine linen, bright and clean, has been given up where? And he says, let us rejoice and be glad, because the day has arrived and the bride has made herself ready. That is it. That is the message. That is actually the message. Because he is essentially saying that even if the garment was already prepared and purchased by Jesus, the church has a role. The church has an active responsibility. Because he's saying the church has made herself ready. Maybe you must accept that grace, right? You must accept that grace. Hallelujah. And when you accept the grace, you must receive it. And when you receive it, you cannot hide it. You must wear it for people to see. Because after all, the Messiah died in the public for everybody to see. When he was feeding the Israelites in the wilderness, he said, count the number of people in your tent. And he poured manna, he poured bread. But when he poured bread, he poured it out there so that they can have a role. So that they can make an effort to go out and gather. Because he is capable. He is able to pour for them in their tents inside. But he did not. In that case of the 16. He did not. Because the children go out and gather. So he said that he has given us the garment. But we must ready ourselves. The question is this. Ever since you received this garment, as a church in Europe, have you maintained it? Finest linen, bright and clean. Or you have matches, you have stains. God bestows upon the church the purpose for the Lord to bring the garment to us is because there was a fall in the garden. Can somebody read from read with me the book of Genesis chapter 3, 22 to 24? Genesis chapter 3, verses 22 to 24. Let me read for you, let me expand you a little bit. I can start from chapter 2, 16, 17, and then chapter 3, 19. Then I read the last one so that you understand better. Right? Chapter 2, 16, 17. He says, and the Lord God commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat of it, you will for sure, surely die.
Herra Jumala käski ihmistä sanoen, syö vapaasta kaikista noista paratiisin puista, mutta hyvän ja pahan tiedon puusta älä syö, sillä sinä päivänä, jona sinä siitä syö, pitää sinut kuolemalla kuolla.
And then,
ja sitten,
when you now read Genesis chapter 3 verse 8, you see that there is a fall. They have disobeyed this command. 3 verse 8.
Look at
this. This is what he says. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. I cannot believe they did that.
Ja he kuulivat, kuinka Herra Jumala käskytteli paratiisissa illan viileydessä. Ja mies vaivainen nymysi Herra Jumalan kasvojen edestä paratiisin puiden selkään. Se on uskomatonta. Ja yhdessä.
But the Lord God called to the man, where are you? Where are you? You can see God going out to his fallen children, looking for them.
Huusi miestä ja sanoi hänelle, missä olet? Hän meni etsimään kadonneita lapsia.
Where are you?
Missä olet?
And he answered, I heard you in the garden and was afraid because I was naked, so I hid away. So these are his children. And he put them in paradise, paradiso. Because in that paradise, the tree of life was here. Look at this now. Then they disobeyed him. And then they ran away, they hid away. When I read verse 9, I always tremble. Because I wonder, I say, no. But he has just begun this project. He could have said, no. This one has begun badly, let me erase it away. Like he did during the time of God. He would still remain God. Let me create another man. But I'm always amazed at verse 9. Look at this now. When the Lord now goes out to look for his fallen children. Could that be, could verse 9 be the beginning of the dispensation of the grace? Could this be the beginning? Because now you see God reaching out to fallen man. Adam and Eve.
Adam.
Where are you? He said, no, we heard you. And we hid away. How can God look for them? Yes, we agree. Whatever the Lord says They were worshiping a calf. And Moses took the stone tablet. And then the Lord said, okay, come back, I'll make another one. Is that the dispensation of grace being pronounced? And Moses really goes up and brings another tablet with the Lord. But what I wanted to bring to your attention, beloved nation of Israel, in verse 19 of Genesis 3, when he says verse 19, by the sweat of your brow you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken. For dust thou art, and to dust thou wilt you return. So you see, he's saying death. Death has come because of disobedience. Death has now entered because of disobedience, beloved people. And then now, look at what happens to the verse we were targeting, 22 to 24. That is what I was targeting. He says, and the Lord God said, men have now become like us, knowing good and evil. We must not allow him to reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat it and live forever. So the Lord God banished him from the garden of heaven to walk the ground from which he had been taken. Verse 24. And he brought the man out and placed on the east side of the garden, okay, two cherubim of many swords, clashing back and forth to guard the way to the tree of life. Let me explain to you what he says. He said that because of the fall of man, now there was a way to the tree of life. If I am you, I had aligned that way. There is a path. There was a special way designed that when he passes, he now goes and enters where the tree of life is. The tree of life. There is a way that our Father designed for us. That if we obey him on step one. Voluntary obedience. Once we obey him, then he will allow us to go through a certain path, a certain way that leads to eternity. Did somebody hear? He's saying that there was a way that was prepared to lead to the tree of life. And he says, the tree of life is the tree whose leaves, when you eat, you live forever. Did you understand this? I want to bring to you so you may understand why I have come to talk about the garden. But I have to give you this knowledge here. So, because of the fall, then look at this now. He put cherubim with flaming sword. Can I just share with the audience on TV a little bit? It is very amazing that the Lord says that, look, man has disobeyed me, has fallen. And the Lord speaks like there is a distress. And he says, let us run and block the way that leads to the tree of life, block it. And he speaks as if there is so much distress. And he's saying that fallen man, sinful man, may not go through that way and pick the leaves of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Doesn't that surprise you? Beloved people, doesn't that surprise you? Those of you watching the television, why am I asking this? Because I was astounded, I was shocked by this scripture. How can sinful man eat the leaves and sinful men live forever? That's why they blocked here. Meaning the leaves of the tree of life. And the Lord has taken me into heaven. And he took me to the throne room. And then he took me even behind the throne room. And I have seen the river of life. And on both sides is the tree of life. What is the man is? I have seen that. The Lord has taken me. But he appears to be saying here that the leaves of the tree of life, there are certain ingredients inside the leaves, inside the ingredients, that when you eat, whether you are a sinner, whether you are a sinner, even if you are a sinner, if you eat, those ingredients make you live forever. That's what he says here. Let me repeat this. It's important you understand this whole translation. He appears to be saying that there are certain ingredients inside the leaves of the tree of life that when anybody eats them, whether you are holy or you are sinful, then you live forever. That shocked me. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So this way was blocked. This way was blocked by cherubim. This is the way that leads to eternity. Where the tree of life is where the Father is. I have so much detail, I'm not sharing with you. There is so much detail I am not sharing here. Some of it is inside, I am not allowed to share, some I'll share. Where the tree of life is where God the Father himself is. Also, whenever the Lord comes, once in a while comes to talk to me, in the dreams, when I see the cherubim, if I just fall asleep like this, and the Lord brings me to a place, and I see the two cherubim of glory, I always know that God the Father must be here. He's here. So there's certain facts. The tree of life is where God the Father is. So listen to me. This way, he said, the way to eternity, the way that leads the tree of life was blocked. But now, January 15th this year, I saw the church taking like this and going like this and following this way and entering heaven this year. I saw. It is open for you. Hallelujah. I saw the church going like this and going like this. Then I said, this is the way that has been blocked because of sin. But now it is open to the church. So what am I trying to say to you with respect to the garment? This is the message I have been trying to build to bring to you, the church in Kenya. That this beautiful garment of righteousness that the Lord is celebrating today and commanding the nation to wear, this garment can also be lost. He said that you may be given the garment and then you lose it.
Amen.
That is amazing. That is the point I wanted to write. Can you read with me, beloved people? The book of Zechariah chapter 3. You can be given the
cup
for free. But if you don't keep it, in other words, if you don't preserve and protect the grace, you will lose the grace. Before we even go to Zechariah chapter 3, we can start with Revelation chapter 16, verse 15. It is right there. 16:15. We are going to go to Zechariah, but let's begin with Revelation 16:15. Apocalypse 16, Pasillo Ince for the Spanish speaking, but Revelation 16:15. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We are going to heaven.
Amen.
Oh yes.
Amen.
We cannot wait. This is the beautiful time in the church where we can make a deliberate decision to enter heaven. This time. We can all decide and enter. Because now wisdom has been born. The spirit has been born. Revival is here. The heavens are open.
Oh, what's that?
The glory